Check. Are we on? Got to button my jacket here, so be careful. I'm an archbishop. Pastor Keith Trump, some of you guys know him. He told me, he said there was this preacher, and he was really short and very wide, and he was preaching, and he finally goes to the crowd. He says, I know what you guys are thinking about how big I am and stuff. And he says, you know, the Bible says we're the temple of the Holy Ghost. He said, I'm a mega church. I thought that was cute. Okay, I'm going to quick do a joke, and then we're going to get right into the Word. Amen? This is a joke I've done before. It's a funny joke, and it's worthy of a repeat. It says, from a friend, he says, I have given up on social media and trying to make friends outside of Facebook while applying the same underlying principles. Every day I walk down the street and tell passerbys what I've eaten, how I feel, what I did the night before, and what I will do tomorrow. Then I give them pictures of my family, my dog, and me gardening. I also listen to their conversations and tell them I love them. And it works. I already have 3 people following me, 2 police officers and a psychiatrist. I thought that was a cute joke, so. All right. Praise the Lord of glory. Who's excited about the Word? Let's get into the Word. Amen? I'm excited about the Word. I've entitled this message, Tearing Garments and Busting Wineskins. You know, the Bible talks about trying to put new wine into old wineskins, right? We're going to talk about that today. And here's what I mean by that. I've been a Christian now for 31 and a half intense years. I've always loved the Lord. Multitudes of mistakes. I know you haven't made any, but I've made quite a few. But just it's called being human and learning to walk. Amen. But with that said, for years I had some of the new covenant. I understood that it was about Jesus, but I also had a lot of law in me. I also thought it was about how I was doing rather than how Jesus did. Amen. Can anybody relate? And that's why you get discouraged and depressed, because when you start looking at yourself and you feel like you're not measuring up, which is often, then you're depressed. Or if you feel like you are measuring up, you tend to be self-righteous. You tend to look down on other people that you perceive that aren't doing as well as you're doing. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Amen? Well, the truth is that Jesus measured up. The Bible says in Hebrews 10:14, for by one offering he has perfected forever those who are sanctified or set apart. That the offering was Jesus. Which leads me, I'm going to give you an example here before we get into the wineskins and garments. Go to Psalm chapter 50, verse 5 on the screen, please. Psalm 50, verse 5. This is an example of how I thought. This is an example. And hopefully we're going to get far enough that I'm going to talk about how to put new wine in the new wineskins. Amen? All right. This is a verse that I remember. This is how I thought. Gather my saints together unto me, those that have made a covenant with me, by sacrifice. And I literally thought, because of the way I was taught, that this was talking about my sacrifice. How much I sacrificed praise to him, or how much I sacrificed. It's not about your sacrifice. Christianity, true Christianity, is not about your sacrifice for God. It's about his sacrifice for you. Good news, amen? But it's amazing to me how we start off believing in what Jesus has done, and then somehow we revert back to us. And we're taught that. And boy, I got a lot to say about this, because I'm going to tell you why even preachers, sometimes even that start seeing these things, revert back to old covenant mentality. You know why? Because old covenant mentality, most people relate to condemnation and making you feel bad to get you to do something. I'm not doing it. Why? Because it's antichrist to preach to you that it's about you and not Jesus. I will challenge you to get into the Word. I will challenge you to pray and seek the Lord, but not for the purpose of pleasing God, but for the purpose of knowing Him and knowing how pleased He is with you because of the sacrifice of His Son. Amen. Look at this. Romans chapter. So this is not talking about my sacrifice. Go to Hebrews 13:15. I'll show it to you in the New Testament. Watch this. Hebrews 13:15. Look at this. By him, therefore. Now, this is another one I saw in a warped way. By him. The word by, it means through him. Who's him? Jesus. Therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. Now watch this. I looked at this as, it's like the by him part didn't really hit me. I saw it, but I didn't see it, if you know what I'm saying. It was always, Chris, you offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually, and you make sure you're constantly praising him. And if you're not, condemnation. I would feel condemned because I wasn't praising God enough. That's not what he's talking about. What he's talking about is if you see Jesus, praise is an automatic response. I'm not saying you might not have to, well, I feel like crying and whining, but I'm just going to look at the goodness of God. I'm not saying you're not going to make decisions there, but I am saying when you understand through him, when we offer the sacrifice of praise, we're rejoicing in what Jesus has done, not in what we're doing. My word, that's good. Well, I'll tell you what, I've been taught stuff like, man, you got to break through, you got to fight, you got to get in, you got to usher the presence of God in, you got to do all these things, only to be constantly and consistently frustrated, and I would just try harder. I would just try. It's kind of like the story I heard one time of the man, and they took him out, his son took his son out to the beach, and they would go to the beach, and the boy said, he goes, when I was a kid, I'd look at my dad, and he would go out, and he would just go float on his back, and he was so good at floating on his back that he would almost fall asleep in the just floating on his back, you know, in the water. He said, I went out, and the harder I tried to float on my back, the more I sank. And he said, but when I learned to let the water carry me, guess what? I could float on my back. That's the way it is in the Christian life. When we learn to let the life of Christ carry us, you know, I love not being condemned. I love it. You know, I'll give you an example. I'm thankful for this revive thing that's come. But you know what? I'm a busy guy. I can only get there so much. And I'm not condemned. At all. I'm not condemned when I say, you know what? I'm going to spend the night with my family. Not even a little bit. Because I trust the leading of God on the inside of me to tell me. Now, I'm not saying there's that time is going to be hard. But see, people... Let me say this to you. When you're zealous for God, some of the most condemned people in the body of Christ are zealous for God. Because they love God and they want to please God and they want to do the things that are right to God. But see, it all starts by understanding that through the blood of Jesus and what Jesus has done, you're in right standing with God and you can't be any righter, I know that's not good English, than you already are because the Bible says you're complete in Him. When you start understanding that, praise explodes from the inside of you because my word, how good is God? And that's why we tell you God's good even when you're not. Some people hear that and they think, oh man, you know me, that means I can go out and be bad. You can go out being bad. Sin is dumb in a million ways. Amen? The wages of sin are still death, but I'm telling you, even in the midst of your sin, God is not rejecting you. And God is not condemning you. He already did that at His Son, upon His Son at the cross some 2,000 years ago. And the more you see that, the more it's going to have fruit in your life. You're going to have your fruit unto holiness. Holiness is a fruit, not a root. Amen. All right. So those are just some of the ways I looked at those verses. Christianity is not about my sacrifice for God, but it's about His sacrifice for me. Somebody say amen. Amen. Let me one more verse on that. 1 Timothy 2:5. I want to show you that. This. For there is one mediator. Somebody say one. A mediator is a go-between. Somebody who bridges the gaps between two parties that are at opposition with each other. There's one mediator, not two. There's one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. God became a man, right? And so made the covenant with himself, right? Correct? So there's one mediator between God and men, not Jesus and my performance. See, the equation of Christianity is Jesus plus nothing equals everything. When you say Jesus plus anything, that equals nothing. That's why the Bible says stand fast in the liberty or the freedom wherewith Christ has made us free and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. What is the yoke of bondage? Trying to measure up to God with my performance. That's a yoke of bondage. I did a post yesterday. If the burden is not light, the yoke is not Christ. Even when you're going through something, His strength is there for you. Amen? So that's why it's good news. And I say this all the time, and people look at you kind of dumb. But I say, you know the gospel's still good news even after you're born again? Really? See, it's good news. Come just as you are. But 2 weeks down the road, it's just as you better be. Right? Just as I am without one plea. And then we come just as we are. And then we're beat up because we're not what we're supposed to be. See, it becomes about us and not Him. That's a trick of the devil. Amen? All right. Let's start talking about tearing garments and busting wineskins. Now, this parable is told in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Those are called the Synoptic Gospels. Synoptic means seeing together. The Gospel of John is different than the Synoptics. So whenever something's in Matthew, Mark, and Luke in the Synoptics, guess what? It's pretty important. This is really, really important. And we're going to look at it. It's in Matthew chapter 9, Mark chapter 2, and Luke chapter 5. But we're going to look at it in Luke 5. Look at Luke chapter 5. We'll begin with verse 36 through 39, which is the end of the chapter. But And he spake also a parable unto them. And notice what Jesus spake a parable unto them, saying, no man putteth or puts a piece of a new garment upon an old. Why not? If otherwise, then both the new maketh the rent or the tear, and the piece that was taken out of the new agrees not with the old. Let me just read it and I'll come back. We'll come back. Next verse. Verse 37. And no man puts new wine into old bottles, else the new wine will burst or break the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. Next verse. But new wine must be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. Next verse. No man also having drunk old wine straightway, the word straightway, Old English for immediately, he doesn't immediately desire the new, for he says the old is better. Now what this is talking about, as you go back to verse 36, it's talking about trying to put the wine or the cloth of the new covenant into an old covenant mindset. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. And when you get to that last verse, and he makes this statement, no man having drunk the old immediately desires the new. I was meditating on this, and all of a sudden I started thinking about it. You know, it takes people a while to adjust to the new covenant. And especially takes Christians. I know Christians that, you know, we've been born again for a long time, for years, and it's very difficult for them to see the new covenant. So they tend to gravitate back towards the familiar. You know, people like the familiar even if it's not good. Research has shown that abused women, a lot of times that have grown up in those types of situations, will often get into abused relationships, not because they're good, but because they're familiar. Amen? And it's the same way here. No man having drunk or partaken of the old covenant mindset immediately desires the new. He says the old's better. I've heard people say, preachers especially, hey, elite man, you preach the old covenant, at least people are doing something, right? We'll get people activated. But listen, I want you to be activated out of your relationship with God. And I'm going to tell you something, that takes a while. That takes a while. And you got to hear and hear. You can't grasp the grace of the new covenant without the help of the Holy Ghost. We need the Holy Spirit to help us understand the new covenant.
Amen.
Amen? You know, people will test. When we first started preaching the new covenant, I don't know how many years ago it's been now, if we really started preaching it, and of course we've grown and we're still growing in our understanding. But we started preaching and proclaiming that, there were people saying, whoa, you're giving people a license to sin. Because it sounds like that. In fact, let me show it to you and we'll come back here. Romans 6:1. Romans chapter 6 and verse 1. Paul says this, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Stop. This is what people hear a lot of times when you preach the new covenant. Listen, I believe in works. Just don't believe in dead works. Dead works are any work that I offer to God in exchange for a blessing He's given to me. You're ordained to good works, Ephesians 2:10. You're created unto good works. Did you know that? That's who you are. One of the reasons there's so many frustrated Christians is because they're not functioning in what they're created to function in. How many know a fish that's not in water is a frustrated fish? Or a dead fish, right? Why? Because he's created to function in water. You're created, ordained of God, to function in good works. Titus tells us, we're in the book of Titus, Paul says, we're to be zealous of good works. Amen? We're to be doers of the word of God, not just hearers. James 1:22, right? So I believe in that, but the problem is people cannot differentiate from dead works to works of faith, or works as a byproduct of who they are. And that's a dangerous place to be. Because we see, if you're growing, you're understanding, my word, I am created unto good works. I do have a desire to do something. I do have a calling on my life. God has called me to do something. Amen. Okay, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Next verse. God forbid. God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? God didn't set me free from sin so I could go live in it. But see, if you don't preach grace to the place that some people misunderstand it, you're not preaching the gospel Paul preached. Amen. You're not preaching the same gospel, because some people are going to misunderstand it. Some people say, wow, you're giving me a license. I've been wanting to be lazy the whole time. But that's not who you are. We're trying to get us to identify with who we are in Christ. Now back to Luke chapter 5, 36. Let's look at it again and we'll walk through it. Luke chapter 5 and verse 36. And he spake also a parable to them. No man puts a new piece of cloth no man putteth a piece of a new garment, I'll get it right, upon an old garment. If otherwise both the new makes the rent or the tear, and makes it worse, the other accounts say, and the piece that was taken out of it agreeth not with the old. Listen to the Greek for agreeth. I wrote this down. The word agreeth means, it's a Greek word, it means to agree together, from a word which means harmonious. Let me say this to you. You can't take the old covenant mindset and make it harmonize with the new covenant. The new covenant is not an add-on to the old covenant. Amen? But... It's not an addition. It's not. When Jesus said in John chapter 13 and verse 34, he told his disciples, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another even as I have loved you. Notice he said it was a new commandment, not an additional commandment. Amen. But the church says, well, just add this on to all the other rules we're keeping. Christianity is not about rules you keep, but about a life that keeps you. It's not touch, not taste, not handle, not. It's about, man, I'm a new creation in Christ. It's contrary to my nature to operate. That's why people are frustrated, because they operate contrary to their nature. Christians, I'm talking about. So it doesn't agree. You cannot make these covenants harmonize. The old covenant, you approach God based on you. The new covenant, you approach God based on Jesus. In the old covenant, you get what you deserve. In the new covenant, you get what Jesus deserves. I like the new. Amen. I like the new. And I'll say this again for those of you who don't. Even in the old covenant, guys, the children of Israel could not keep the 613 commandments that were required for right standing with God. They could not do it. That's why they gave him this sacrificial system. That's why when you read about the Balaam, the prophet who told Balak tries to get him, the Moabite king, to curse the children of Israel. He said, I can't curse what God has blessed. And it even says in that account, God says, I have not beheld iniquity in Israel. I haven't beheld it. I haven't seen it. Why? Because of the animal sacrifices, which were a type of the blood of Christ. But as soon as they were taught to come out from under the animal sacrifices and to get into idolatry, immediately there had to be judgment. That's why if God made the covenant directly with you and me, as soon as I break it or you break it, there has to be judgment. But guess what? He made it with Jesus. So there's going to be no judgment there. And as long as I keep my faith in Jesus, the righteousness of the law is filled in us, not by us. In us, not by us. Glory to God, that's good news. Amen. Man, we need to rejoice. But see, when I get out from under that, the Bible says in Galatians 3 that it says, cursed is everyone who continues not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. If I'm under a law mentality, I will walk under some kind of curse that Christ has redeemed me from, because I'm trying to measure up to God's standard in my own strength. And it's frustrating, and it's not good. The new covenant's good news, and it continues to be good news because it is about Jesus. Amen. So he spake a parable. You cannot get the old covenant mentality of approaching God based on your merit to agree with the new covenant mentality that's based upon the merit of another named Jesus. Amen. Amen. I'm coming right back. I got to show you this. I know we've talked about this, but God's been dealing with me. Say things over and over and over. People don't get it. I mean, it takes me a while. I don't know, maybe you get it the first time. Go jump over to Galatians 3, 19, and we'll come right back. Galatians 3, 19, and we'll come back to verse 37 of Luke 5. Wherefore then, or why then, serves the law? Why? What was the purpose of the law? It was added because of transgressions or sins, till the seed, singular, should come, to whom the promise was made, and it was ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator. Next verse, or a go-between. Now a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. When Moses mediated, he stood between God and man, but he had to bring the law, right? But when Christ came, that's what it says. A mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. What does this mean? It used to confuse me so much. He said a go-between, it requires two parties to go between. But it says God is one. God is one. See, God became man, and he actually mediated this covenant for us. We read that in 1 Timothy 2:5. There's one mediator between God and man. The man, Christ Jesus. He's the go-between, so God makes the covenant with him, and guess what? You can't blow it, and neither can I. You can mess your life up. You can go out and do dumb things and pay the price. You know, spirit, soul, and body. I heard the person that was leaving a Rhema conference years ago, and they got pulled over by the police officer, and the police officer said, hey, I just heard that in my spirit, I never sin. I just heard that at a conference. And the officer says, well, I'm going to give a ticket to your body. Amen. All right. Some of you will get that later. Back to Luke chapter 5. We'll look at verse 37. So verse 36, you cannot get these covenants, the old, to agree with the new. You have to approach God based on Jesus and not you. Verse 37, and no man puts new wine into old bottles. Why? Else the new wine will break or burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. Keep that at verse 37. For just a moment, I want to say, new wine will break the old. New wine will break the old. If you try to cram new covenant mentality around, down some, I'm learning this all the time. People can't hear it. So you got to meet. How many know it took you a while to get the revelation of the new covenant? Some of you are here and maybe don't even have that. You still think it's about you. Well, he's a good man. He's a good woman. Or he's a good woman. I got to be careful in our society. It's so much confusion. It's even hit the bullpen. But you know, none of us. We always say, why? How do bad things happen to good people? We should say, why do good things happen to bad people? Everybody's a mess. Everybody needs Jesus. That's why God gave the law. Not so man could keep it, but to show man that he couldn't keep it and he needed a Savior. That was the purpose of the law. Till the seed should come. So he would stop trusting in himself. But you go to church many times and they'll tell you, you just need to try harder. You just need to do more. You need to try more. But yeah, I know, I'm not doing enough. If I sat up here and said, how many of you are not praying enough? We're more concerned about our air condition than our prayer condition. Yada, yada, yada. I could go on and on. But yeah, amen. I'm not really doing very good. We could all identify with that. But how many of you know Jesus did great? How many know God wants us to rejoice in his son and what he did? But so many times we're more sin conscious than we are son conscious. Amen. And that's the problem. That's what's eating people up. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, even when I act like a meathead. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, Chris, if you say that, people are going to go nuts. You're going to give them a license to sin. People are sinning just fine without a license. Amen. I believe if you try to put new wine, it'll break the bottles of new covenant understanding, and you'll lose it. You'll perish. The Bible says in Proverbs 18, verse 19, that a brother offended is harder to be won than a strong city, and their contentions are like the bars of a castle. Once somebody's offended and they think, man, you're just given license to sin, you're one of them greasy gracers, sloppy agape people, and when they think that, they'll I'm staying away from them. Amen. Next verse. Verse 38. And then I'm going to talk about how to put new wine in the new wineskins. Verse 38, and it says, but new wine must, everybody say must, be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. If you put new wine in the new bottle, both are preserved. When you hear the new covenant, guess what? It just keeps getting better. I get more revelation. I marvel at Christians, I say this all the time, that think they know the word. I marvel at it. I get stuff all the time. I was reading Mark chapter 3 the other day. I'm not going to go into it, maybe sometime. And I was just minding my own business, praying in the Spirit like I do when I read the Word. And I was just reading it. And all of a sudden, oh my word, this is awesome. When did you put this in here, Lord? Been in there the whole time. I started looking up some words. And I thought, oh my word, this is awesome. This is so good. Started talking about how Jesus went into the synagogue and how Jesus went into the religious system, and God just started showing all this stuff to me. I thought, man, Lord, I got to chew on that. That's how God, I feel sometimes when I walk around, I feel like I'm walking around with constant good teaching going on all the time in me. Hello, Holy Ghost. That's why when you pray in the Spirit and you get in that habit more and more and more of praying in the Spirit, you're activating the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And all the Word of God that's in you just comes alive. And if you're not interested in the things of God, God loves you enough to respect that. You know why hell was created? The Bible says God has no pleasure in the death of the wicked. It was created for the devil and his angels. Matthew 25, 41. But basically, if people don't want God, God will honor that throughout eternity. You know why there's no light in hell? Because God is light. It's the total absence of God. And if people don't want him, he'll honor that. But he has no pleasure in the death of the wicked. He wants all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And he wants Christians to be saved. I didn't say born again. You can't be a Christian unless you're born again. But he wants them to come into the understanding of what Christ has made available to them. All right, moving right along. So both are preserved. It says, the word preserved, this is a great, great Greek word. Soon, tereo. Everybody say soon? Mm-hmm. It's spelled like our English sun. That's a preposition. It means with or together. And tereo means to keep or to guard. It means to stay in the state in which one is. Isn't that good? But you put them together. Soon means together. They're preserved. You'll stay in the state in which you are. You put new wine into new bottles. You put new covenant understanding into new covenant bottles and teaching doctrine into new covenant understanding, and both are preserved. Everybody say preserved. What is new covenant understanding? It's understanding that it ain't about you. I say this a lot. Humility is not thinking more of yourself. It's not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking none of yourself because you're consumed with him. You know why people are depressed? If you're depressed, you're focused on you. Amen. That's the bottom line. Then God doesn't. God loves you. God loves you so much, he had me say that. Amen? We all battle with it. It's not never a condemning thing, but I got to say, you know what? It's because I'm focused on me. Hallelujah. You know what jealousy is? Anybody know? You know why people get jealous? I'll tell you exactly why. Jealousy is rooted in the belief. If I see you have something, and I'm jealous of what you have, in my heart, I believe that God is shortchanging me because he took something from me to give it to you. So it's a belief in a small God that makes me jealous of you because you have something that I think I should have. And in my mindset, God took that from me to give it to you, so therefore I'm in lack. If you understand that you're complete in Christ and what he did, it doesn't matter. You know, what I love about the Lord, the freer I get in my heart, the freer I am to be who God created me to be. And he's only equipped you to be what he's called you to be. This book where I told you about this book, and it just, where these people, these near-death experiences, and they've done tons and tons of research. But one of the things that really grabbed my attention was when the one guy said, when he stood before the Lord, he said, the first person that you come in contact with is yourself. And he went on to explain that. He said, because so many people in life beats us down, and it beats us into a mold, and we're afraid to be who God's created us to be, right? We get beat in this mold, and we conform, because that's what you have to do, right? We're in that position. But, you know, once you're free, there's so much potential in every one of us. God's put that potential in us. But fear keeps us trapped. How many people are called of God to do great things for the kingdom of God, but they've been beat down? No, you don't do that. You just sit down, shut up, and you just mind your own business, and you just be normal. What's normal? What is normal? Well, it's like me, obviously. I'm the standard, and if you're not, the closer you are to me, the closer you are to normal, right? That's what everyone thinks. Maybe you're weird and they're normal. Okay, moving right along. New wine must be put in new bottles if both are to be preserved. Next verse. Hallelujah. Okay, we're doing good. No man having drunk old straightway or immediately desires new, for he says the old is better. Now, and I got immediately. In other words, it takes time. Everybody say it takes time. It takes time. No man, when he's used to the old covenant, immediately desires the new. Because he says the old is better. Why? Because he or she is familiar with the old covenant. And as I said earlier, people like familiarity. Now, moving right. Oh, no, I want to read this to you. This is good. And I got it. It says, a friend and I were at a campfire. Suddenly we saw a snake come out of the flames, wiggling in pain. My friend reached into the flames and pulled out the snake to save it. And when he did, it bit his hand. My friend's reaction was to shake the snake loose. And when he did, it fell back into the fire. He immediately reached back into the fire to pluck it out again, and it bit him again. He shook the snake free only to see it fall back into the fire. As he started to reach out once again to pull the snake from the fire, I called out to him. Hey, don't be a fool for the third time. If it bit you the first two times, it will bite you again. His response stopped me in my tracks. He said, just because the nature of the snake is to bite me, that doesn't mean that I will alter my nature, which is to help. Hang with me. With that, he picked up a stick and reached in to finally pull out and free the snake from the fire and certain death. The moral is simple. Don't allow the negative nature of some or all those around you to change the positive nature that God has given to share given you to share with all. Nothing wrong with being smart, use a stick, but help, save, support, encourage, and strengthen those around you, regardless of their actions or reactions. Focus more on who you are and who you represent than what others say or think about you. Isn't that good? And that's what this reminded me of with this verse. No man having drunk old immediately desires the new, for he says the old is better. You know, God's called us more to just sit in our church and never interact with other Christians. Because we got the new covenant and they don't. Boy, it's quiet in here. Amen. God wants us to get involved. One of the things I'm so excited about this revival thing is at least people are interacting. Come on. They're our brother and sister in Christ if they're born again. Amen. Just because some people are messed up. Listen, everybody's messed up, including us. Amen. Come on. God wants to shake the world, and it'll happen when they see our love one for another. And those that are hungry for the new covenant, God will draw them here. Amen. But we got to get out. We got to intermingle. We got to realize we're not the only one. There's other people that God's using, and we get the privilege of being a part. Amen. Man, that's good news. Hey, you may get wiser. Use a stick. Instead of blowing them over with the new covenant, hey, God's not mad. You know, you may have to temper it a little bit. And the Bible says the tongue of the wise uses knowledge aright, but the mouth of fools pours out foolishness. All right. Praise God. How do you put new wine in the new wineskins? Go to Galatians chapter 6, verse 7 and 8. How much time are we looking at, Mark?
You got about 20 minutes.
Oh, praise God.
Or 13, sorry.
Okay. All right. Okay. How many guys give me 5 minutes? Come on. 1, 5, 10. Come on, 15? Come on, I'm gonna get 3 hours here. I'm just kidding. Brian gave me that joke. All right, what did I say? How do you put new wine, new covenant, understanding into new wineskins? I'm gonna show you this. This is big. Galatians 6, verse 7 and 8. Who knows what the book of Galatians is about? I'll tell you. The book of Galatians is about born again, new covenant Christians that have received the new covenant, right? And a group called Judaizers or legalists were coming in and teaching those people that you have to, yes, it is about Jesus, but it's about Jesus plus what you do if you're going to receive from God. And Paul condemned that doctrine in the strongest terms. He said, let him be accursed. Okay? So how do you put new wine into new wineskins? I'm going to say a couple of things here. Be not deceived. He's talking to Christians, right? So if he's telling Christians to not be deceived, if you're born again, you're going to heaven. But there is so much more than just being saved and stuck and wait till you die and go to heaven. The Bible says if you gain this whole world and lose your soul, what does it profit? And that's not just heaven and hell. That's just if I don't further the kingdom of God. You know, God started showing me the other day. Everybody get on a pity trip. Anybody ever get on a pity trip? Nobody? Just me and Anthony, right? No. You get on a pity trip and you start thinking, what do I really matter? What have I really done? And all of a sudden, God started showing me if I was never born and had never been here, all the things that would not have happened. When Logan was up there, Erica came to me a while back and she said, you know, thank you for introducing me to Andrew Womack. I said, did I do that? Remember something to that? And I'm thinking, you don't know. You don't know all the impact that God wants to use you in this world. Every one of you, if you weren't here, we would be hurting. I mean, the world would suffer. The kingdom would still go on, but the God's perfect plan would not be as good without you. And God wants to increase that. But you need to know you matter. You matter. But see, the enemy wants you to think, no, you don't matter. You're just a person. You're not a preacher. You're not this. You're not. So that is a lie. You matter. And so be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. Next verse. For he that sows to the flesh, which is a continuous action, shall of his flesh reap corruption, but he that sows to the Spirit, leave this verse up there, shall of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Now, I always thought sowing to the flesh was, you know, smoking and dipping and chewing and going with girls, all that stuff. All the bad things per se, the works of the flesh. But that's not what he's talking about. You know what sowing to the Spirit is? Sowing to the new covenant understanding in your life. That's consistent with the whole book. When you sow understanding of what Jesus has done in your walk, you're sowing to the Spirit. Amen? But when you sow to the, how do you sow to the flesh? Here's how you sow to the flesh. If I get up here and tell you, you just need to try harder, you need to be better, you need to be nicer, you need to do all these things, I'm sowing to your flesh unless I tell you that it's through the strength of Christ. Amen? That you can't do this, but Christ in you can do this. Christianity is not about living for God, but it's about Christ living through you. Christ in you is the only hope of glory. See, so if I tell it to you that way, that's good. But if I tell you it's all about you and your effort without Christ, that is sowing to your flesh. If I make it about rules instead of what he did, I'm sowing to your flesh. Now, how do you put new wine into new wineskins? New covenant understanding, or new covenant doctrine into new covenant understanding. How do you do that? Now, before I go to the context here, I want to say this to you. Some of these verses I refrain from. You know why? Because of pride on my part. What will they think? They'll think my motive, that I have motives, and I don't. I can't help it if you think I do. I must be share with you the whole counsel of God. Amen? Let me show you how to sow to the new covenant. Back up to verse 6 from the Amplified Bible. I want to show it to you from the leave it there and then we'll go to the Amplified. 6. Let him that receives instruction in the word of God share all good things with his teacher, contributing to his support. Next verse. Be not deceived and deluded. God will not allow himself to be sneered at or mocked. His scorned, disdained, or mocked by mere pretensions or professions, or by his precepts being set aside. He inevitably deludes himself, who attempts to delude God, for whatever a man sows, and that only is what he will reap. Here's my point. I want to say this to you. Here's one of the ways you put new wine into new wineskins. You support ministries that are teaching the new covenant.
Amen.
That's how you do it. It doesn't matter. It does matter. It does matter. If you get up and somebody gets on TV and they're berating you and they're telling you and they talk you into it and they're telling you all their need, but if they're not preaching the new covenant, don't support them because you're sowing to the flesh. But if they're preaching the new covenant, sow to them. You know how we've had people from this country and other countries that have contacted us through social media and said how they wish they had a church like this one. Why are you saying that? Because it's the truth. It does matter. We need to put new wine into new wineskins. We need to value the new covenant above what people do to try to coerce us into doing something. See, this is what makes it hard. These people that get up and do these stuff, they make it hard on people like us who are trying to let God lead you. Whew, thank you, Jesus. Now you know why I don't share those verses. But you know I'm going to share them. The Lord said, share them. They're in my word, and you need to share them. How much value does God put on this? 1 Timothy, we've already received the offering, by the way. Okay, so this isn't a ploy. I don't do that. Guys, let me tell you something. I have seen so much abuse in the body of Christ. Most people are not rejecting truth. They're rejecting some abuse they've seen to that truth. I've seen people lock the doors. There's so many people in here going to give $1,000 a piece. I've seen all that nonsense. If God's telling you, keep your mouth shut, He'll tell them. Amen. How much value does God put on His Word? Let's go to King James, 1 Timothy 5:17, and then we'll move on. That's one way you put new wine into new wineskins. We're about down to 5 minutes. Five, thank you. I figured that. Man, I'm... Let the elders, the leaders that rule well, be counted worthy of double honor. And this is talking financially, by the way. Now you know I've really been scared to share this one. We've already received the offering. Especially they who labor in the word and doctrine. How important is the word and doctrine? What does God think of it? That's why I say this all the time. Well, I'm good. I already know the word. I hear people talk. I hear people share that love God and I can relate to them because they're exactly like I used to be. They're condemned because they feel like they're not measuring up. All right. Now, the next one. So that's one way. Sowing to the flesh and sowing to the spirit. What's another one? Putting new wine into new wineskins. Understanding worldliness. Understanding worldliness. 1 John chapter 3, verses 1. Through 3. Look at this. Behold. Everybody say behold. The word behold means look. What manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us. Here it is. Here's the manner of love that God has bestowed upon us. That we should be called the sons of God. That's awesome. That's the manner of love. What are we to behold? The fact that God says we're in His family. If you're born again, you're in the family of God. Wow. Wow. How many of you know there's a difference between someone that's in the family and someone that comes over from next door? Right? You're in the family. And see, in the world, now look at this. Therefore, the world knows us not because it knew Him not. Remember what they said to Jesus? Isn't this the carpenter's son? Who is this guy? How is he made? How can he be a son of God? This isn't right. How can he be God's son? That's the same thing they say about you. They look at you and they say, I know Rich. Oh, my word, the guy likes the Seahawks. How can he be God's son? Don't even make sense, right? At least he could like a good football team. I'm kidding. Sorry, Rich. I went over to the Seahawks. I'm frustrated with everybody else. I don't like it. I just like a good game. But anyhow, the world doesn't understand it because all the world understands, well, how, if you're a son of God, then how can you be that? I've looked at your performance and you're not perfect, right? That's why they don't understand that. You just look like everyone else, and you're telling me you're a son of God. No, God said that. That's why he says you have to behold at what kind of love God has bestowed upon you, that you should be called a son of God. You need to marinate in his love for you. You need to meditate on it. You need to soak in it. You need to pray in the Holy Ghost and keep yourself in the love of God. Amen. Next verse. That's why you do that, never to earn. Beloved, now. Somebody say now. What's a procrastinator? Someone who won't take now for an answer, right? Beloved, now are we the sons of God. It doth not yet appear what we shall be. These are not our glorified bodies, right? But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. What that's saying is when your hope is anchored in him, you have your fruit unto holiness, and it has a purifying effect in your life. One more, and then we're done. Because I've heard people say this more than once. We need to preach on sin because people need to know what they're getting saved from. I agree, people need to know what they're getting saved from, but preaching on sin, people already know they're sinners. Did you know that? Amen. Is that in the Bible? Oh, yeah. I'm going to show it to you. Do you know people already know they're sinners? You know, there are some people that have deceived themselves that don't know they're sinners, and that's where you use the law. Amen? But just to walk up to somebody and say, man, you're a sinner. Most people know that. Okay? But I'm going to show you there is a time when you use the law, and that's only upon people that have deceived themselves and believe that they're all right without Christ. Amen? All right. Hallelujah. We need to preach on Christ, not on sin. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5. I actually heard somebody say this. There's too much preaching on Jesus and not enough preaching on sin. Wrong. For we preach not ourselves, but sin. I told you about I've sat around with these ministers and I've said, well, so what have you all been preaching? And one old timer goes, sin. I thought, can I come to your church? I want to feel bad. We preach not ourselves, but what do we preach? Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves, your servants, for Jesus' sake. Amen? You know, if Jesus is Lord, killing babies will not be? Amen. You know, I could name a giant church. Progressive, liberal, believes in abortion, killing babies, believes in all kinds of marriage that Scripture doesn't teach. You can be liberal and be born again, but you cannot be liberal and love God's word because that stuff's wrong. There is right and there is wrong, and God's word is the standard. Amen. But see, if we would preach the lordship of Jesus Christ, that stuff would take care of itself. Amen. Oh, glory to God. Let me show you quickly and then we'll wrap up. People know they're sinners, but some people have deceived themselves and they don't know they're sinners. And that's where you use the law. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. Romans 1, 18. We're just about done. For the wrath of God is revealed or has been revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold or suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Next verse. Because that which may be known of God is manifest or made known in them, for God has shown it unto them. You know what that's saying? God's wrath is revealed. People know in their heart that they're lacking and they're missing something. That's why instead of preaching their lack, we need to proclaim to them the answer. That God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing men's trespasses unto them, and has committed unto us, his church, the word of reconciliation, that now through Jesus, you can be restored to favor with God. And that favor doesn't fluctuate when your performance does. 2 Corinthians 5:19. Amen? Yeah, amen? Amen. So quickly, we need to put new wine into new wineskins. And if we try to take new covenant understanding and push it on people with an old wineskin mentality or an old garment mentality, the rent gets worse. And when a brother's offended, they can't receive the things of God. They can't receive the new covenant. Every believer needs the new covenant. I spent years as a believer, love God, born again, but always felt like I never measured up. I've always felt like I never prayed enough. Still do when I look at me. You know, because the Bible says pray without ceasing. That's my dream, to be in constant communion with God. But you know, I find myself, you know, not doing that. God still loves me. Just knowing that God will never reject me Man, just gives me puts a spring in your step, a lightness, knowing that God is like, you know, the church will condemn you many times because it wants people to get people activated. And we're, as I said earlier, we're created to be activated. But listen, not through condemnation. Not through condemnation, but out of relationship. I bring the trash out for my wife. Now that's an example of law. Just a quick little joke. That was a joke. No, because I love, actually because I don't want it to stink in the house. I'm kidding. And I don't know where that came from. All right. So let's continue to put new covenant understanding in the new wineskins. And when we run up to someone and we realize that they got an old covenant understanding, we need to work. We need to keep pointing them to Jesus. We need to keep saying it's about Jesus. And all of a sudden, it'll click. I mean, if people got a teachable heart, it will click. The hardest thing is religious hardness. Because, you know, I know people that grew up in this church and they're not going to change. They don't care what the Bible says. They really don't care because they're comfortable in that. Amen? I don't want to be comfortable in something that's not God. Amen? And that's why you just maintain a teachable attitude. And the good news is when your heart finally understands and it turns to the Lord and it realizes that it's about what He did. The Bible says that veil's removed from your heart and all of a sudden you can see it. And the gospel actually becomes good news. Amen. Praise God. Give the Lord a hand.